Hey folks, me again, here for a Wonderland update and why I'm not sidestepping time for now and how I made $400,000 the other day. Righty-tighty. Okay, I've made a few little points here. It doesn't really matter if you can't see them. It's just really for me just to stay on track. Now, the important thing to know when we're in a bear market is that when major assets crash, they don't crash to zero, typically. And I'm talking about a major asset. So if we look at Bitcoin over here, every time Bitcoin has crashed, it only crashes sort of 80 to 90%. So if we look here from the top of the drop to the bottom of the drop for Bitcoin back in 2018, which was a pretty severe bear market, that was an 84.11% drop. Again, if you look at one of the previous crashes, so if we go back to sort of, it's not on this chart. But anyway, if we look at even this more recent drop from sort of in July, we go from top of drop to bottom of drop. That was only 71%. And this is pretty typical, remember, of major assets. And when I say major assets, stuff which is more than $1 billion market cap. Now, when we're looking at time, what is top of drop to bottom of drop? So if we have a little look-see, we then go from top of drop right at the top of that wick to the bottom, we're looking at a 79.72% drop at the moment. And again, if you look at wrapped memo, which basically accounts for the price and all of the rebases, top of drop to bottom of drop takes us down to about 39%. So it's not that bad. That's because of the rebases. Now, one of the reasons why I have paused my sidestepping activity is that I think the market is just filled with fear at the moment. And some of it is quite warranted. I do believe we are still in for some sort of shock across the board. Time, I think, has really has done most of its move. And that's the purpose of sidestepping. It's to aggressively protect capital during volatile periods of crashing, which we have done beautifully as a community. I think we are near the lows. And the thing with sidestepping is that it's beautiful during the meaty, easy, low-hanging fruit stuff, so sort of all this stuff over here, but the last sidestep will normally screw you over. So I want to tell you about a little story where I was unlucky and also lucky at the same time, and it's Ether. If we go back to Ether back in 2018, we obviously had the big crash in January 2018, and it broke support. Now, I got out of Ether a lot later than I would have liked, but that's because it was so volatile. It literally just crashed violently, very, very fast. And I sort of got out of my Ether holdings around sort of 850-ish with this rising compression here. And it dropped like an absolute stone, and it was great. And over the next year and a bit, I did loads of sidesteps. I did so many sidesteps, it was ridiculous. In fact, let's look at this drop. So right at that peak to that drop over there, that was a 74% crash before it then bounced up a bit. But it then went a lot lower over time. So if we then take this all the way down to this low, it was about a 94% crash. Horrendous, right? Anyway, I do what I do, and I increased my Ether holdings by over 400% from sort of March 2018 all the way down to sort of October 2018. So most of that year I was just sidestepping, and all I was doing was compressions. Compression, 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 compression. I prefer rising compressions. Rising compressions have a very high probability outcome. When it's sort of symmetrical like this, its direction is unknown. And so it was basically compression central, and every single time I saw a compression, I exited, waited for the drop to at least base support and a little bit below, bought back in. Another compression, need to get out, etc. And normally the base of each compression is taken out by sort of 50% or so. And it was great until I saw the mother of compressions for Ether. Down here, it sort of started off at about 84, and it was just doing this big old compression. I thought, oh wow, this is huge. This is going to put, you know, Ether down to sort of $50. So what did I do? I exited, I think around 160. I saw this double top. I was, oh, okay, let's get out. And then this happened. And it was horrendous. Bear in mind, I was a good 400% up in my Ether holdings. And then it, and I thought, oh, okay, it's going to Kobo here. It's going to come back to kiss off this support level around sort of 190. And then it's going to bugger off. Kobo, kiss off, bugger off. What did it then do? It then did this. And it was so painful. So this is where I was very unlucky, because this really should have pumped to the downside. So this must have been some sort of news. And then I got very lucky. Now, I'm not often lucky on the markets, because I don't give the market an opportunity to make me lucky, if that makes sense. I don't believe in luck on the markets. I believe in you control your luck with your systems. And if you have a system which has positive expectancy, you are creating your own luck, because you're putting maths on your side. However, in this case, I broke my rules to a bit, and because I should have got in a lot sooner, but I left it. I think I was paralyzed for some reason, mentally paralyzed. But then I got lucky, and then the market came back down to sort of 180. I got back in, and I was like, whew, thank God for that. But then it just carried on falling down a bit, but I just hodled. And then obviously Ether did its thing, and it's been hunky-dory ever since. So the lesson I wanted to share with you there is that sidestepping is amazing until the very last one that screws you over. So when you do sidestepping, or 6-6-ing as I call it, I would also add a little filter to that, is that once the market has crashed 70 to 90%, you need to start being careful with your sidesteps, because you're getting towards that territory where the last sidestep is going to screw you over. And that's where I think we're getting towards with time. The majority of the fall has already happened. I forgot what I said, something like 70-odd%. What was it? I just need to remember. Yeah, almost 80% down. So yes, it could drop a little bit further, but I think now is time to sort of start hodling and just get those rebases. And bearing in mind, Sifu, the treasurer of time, has his liquidation price, the last time I checked, around $1,500. So Sifu is not going to let himself get liquidated. And as you can see here, I saw this crash down to this level here. Then I said we're likely to potentially sail towards 1,500. I think it's highly unlikely that time will get below this. Everyone's looking at the time backing price. Again, if we look at the time backing price, let's just open up this. Probably going to ask me to log in. Yep. Let's log in with my burner wallet. Burner wallet, come on. There we go. That'll do, pig. So if we look at this, the backing price of, 1361. I mean, I personally think it's bullshit. Backing prices for DAOs is utter poppycock. But Sifu is not going to be liquidating himself. So where does that leave us? That means if you were to start hodling now and just like sitting still, no more sidesteps, there's only sort of, let's say it gets down to sort of 1600, there's only another 30% drop. So if you were to look at 30%, let's say it's 950, I'm ignoring compounding. So what is that, 30% divided by, 950. So that's about 15 days worth of, 17 days worth of rebases, 30%. And if you can check, if you do, I'm no Excel spreadsheet wizard, by the way, but you can check this. If you just put in some random memo over here and then work out the rebases. So if you work out, if I figure out, what is it, 6219, obviously this changes. So you then do A1 times 1.006219. brackets to the power of, where's the little hat, 3. There we go. And then let's just bring this down. So a 30% uplift from 10 time or 10 memo is about 13. So basically, yeah, I'm not too far off. So if you were to HODL for, call it 16 to 19 days, you're going to get your 30% uplift, which means even if the market does drop 30-odd% from now, that's only, what, just over 2 weeks worth of HODLing. So I think it's worth sitting still now, even though I still think we could possibly have one more bite at the cherry in terms of another move down, because looking at this on the 12-hour chart, what's forming? The 12-hour chart's forming a rising compression. So it wasn't that obvious earlier, like a few days ago, but it is becoming a lot more obvious now. This looks like another rising compression where we could see another fall sort of back down to sort of 1800 on, at least to 2000, which is the, you know, base structure of this compression. However, we're also in a period where we're somewhat torn, because typically Bitcoin commands whatever everything else does. And when we look at Bitcoin, Bitcoin is looking really freaking toppy, because we have a pretty damn freaking huge head and shoulders, which means, you know, a head and shoulders is basically saying we should at least have a little move down to sort of 30 to 32. I think there's equal probability of three potential scenarios. And by the way, with trading, it's not about like always trying to forecast an exact number. What trading is looking at a market and coming up with some logical outcomes. It's a bit like playing chess. You can't predict what someone's going to do with chess, but what you can do is come up with 3 to 5 different potential scenarios of what your opponent may do for their next move. And what you do with chess is that you have these different scenarios, what may happen, and then you come up with your action plan on what will happen, what you will do based on each potential outcome. So I think with Bitcoin, there's only three real potential outcomes here. We have one outcome where the head and shoulders plays out, and we have a pretty fast crashing down to 30K. So that has, I would say, an equal probability out of the three. So what are you then going to do if that happens? That's up to you. The next probable outcome is that we have another repeat of what happened earlier on in 2021, where again we had a very shitty looking head and shoulders, shoulder, head, shoulder, neckline, and we then had a very sharp reversal straight into another head and shoulders. So yeah, we could just catapult off this $40,000 level back up again. Maybe that's the second option. The third option is that we have the January shenanigans, which is happening right now. The big boys, or Wall Street, it's capital deployment month, and they want to deploy. So where is all of the liquidity? If they want to buy, where is everyone selling? Everyone is basically putting their liquidation levels below the 40K level. Every man and his dog has put some sort of support level across at 40K, saying that, yeah, that's the head and shoulder neckline. They'll start liquidating, or they'll start mentally thinking, right, I'm going to sell if we get below 40K. So there's going to be huge amounts of liquidity between sort of 40 to 38K. So if I was a fund manager wanting a bit of liquidity, or wanting a nice teeny weeny discount, yeah, they may shake that tree a little bit further down to sort of between 36 to 38, let's call it, where there's huge amounts of sell pressure, where that will then gobble up all of their buy orders, so they can then do that. So there's three outcomes. I'm saying right now, I don't know what's going to happen. I don't really give a shit, and nor should you. Trading is not about forecasting. It's about probable outcomes and what you will do based on which outcome happens. And then you take the low risk, high probability outcome trades based on the scenario which you forecasted, or which you factored into your sort of mental contingency. So that's that. So yeah, I think Bitcoin, I mean, out of those scenarios, two of them are coming further falling. So if Bitcoin makes another little sort of mad dash below 40K, we're going to see time sort of play out. So I think, yeah, we probably could have some further falling. But at the same time, we're in this weird limbo zone of where of time looks like it's somewhat disconnecting from its connection with Bitcoin, because Bitcoin's looking very bearish in general. But when we're looking at time, if you sort of look down at the 4-hour chart, we've got an inverted head and shoulders here. Shoulder, head, shoulder, neckline, which is something like this, where the market has breached through the neckline already and is cobowing back to that neckline, where we could see an sort of another move up here. Again, so that's that inverted head and shoulders. If we have a look at, whoopsie daisy, I've already got Raptor Memo open. It's not so obvious there. However, the double bottom, which I've been shouting out on Raptor Memo, is playing out. So that double bottom has already played out. So this is now extinguished, that particular pattern there. So let's get rid of those lines for the moment. And let's go back to time. So we could have this inverted head and shoulders play out, which would be nice, because if this does play out, we're going to see a move back up to 2,500, which then actually creates... okay, let's not go too far just yet. So yeah, going back to the title, I'm not sidestepping. Fear is high. Yep, January is almost over. So capital allocation month, which is now, is almost over. So I think we just got probably one more move down potentially. And I think it's going to be very similar to the capital allocation shenanigans that we saw in Jan 2021. So entered the year on a high, boom. Again, last year, I said exactly the same thing. Fund managers are going to want to deploy. So they're going to shake the tree and then let it do its thing. So here we've had this tree shake. In fact, if you go to my YouTube channel, I actually mentioned this in December. Have a little look at this. Here we go. My current crypto concern, January shenanigans. I said this tree shake would happen, and it did. So let's get back to this because I do waffle. January's almost over. Ether, I've already talked about that. Yeah, so I basically always put my money where my mouth is. I can only talk about what I'm doing myself. And the way that I can effectively put my money where my mouth is and that I'm not sidestepping for now is by locking myself up. How do I lock myself up? Well, basically, you mint. That's how you effectively lock yourself up to a degree. So I remember chatting with some friends as I was coming up with this conclusion probably 4 days ago. I was going, look, I'm bored of sidestepping at the moment. It's stressful. I haven't got time. I'm busy with my normal life. I think we're towards the end. Even if we have a move down here, it's only, 2 to 3 weeks worth of hodling. Screw it. I'm going to lock in a discount and do that. So what I did, as you can see in my Telegram... where was it? Saying there could be a disconnect, blah blah blah. I talked about Sifu, same sort of shizzle. Yeah, we've done lots of lovely side steps from 8.5 down to 2, and lots of us have massively uplifted our time pots. So we now are potentially at the lows. Perhaps it's time to take a bit of a chill pill and hold all out and sit back. And I was basically saying, look, there's some pretty good discounts over here. And so that's basically what I've done. Long story short, in the space of, I guess, 24 hours, I uplifted my time pot from 1290 to 1470. So I had a nice 180.71 time uplift. And for those that are going, oh, bullshit, this doesn't exist, just check my wallet. This is my wallet, ends in 505F9. This is my time wallet, not all my wallets. I've got a bunch of... I treat MetaMask like a bit of a filing cabinet. I have a wallet per currency that I'm in. And for those that have been following, it looks like a fair few have. You would have seen that this was at 2.8 million a couple of days ago. And the only reason for the jump up is not because of the price. The price has actually just stayed pretty sideways for the last few days. As you can see here, hasn't really done much. That 400k, it's probably more like 420k uplift. It's simply due to the memo, the uplift from the discounts. So what I do when I'm in sort of minting mode is I simply stalk the Wonderland website, or the app to be more precise. So if you, there we go, one seat, yeah. So all I do, you have to understand that these minting options over here on the left-hand side, they are a market in itself, and they will change every minute. So at the moment, if we look at this one, 7.48, if I refresh it, it'll probably change. And that's because people are always taking this. So as people are gobbling up these offers, it then makes it weaker and weaker. So for example, if I clicked on this, it says the max I can buy is 801. Now let's say I bought up all 801 of this offer here with this discount. This would then suddenly go negative, like minus 4%. So that's that. And yeah, so basically over the space of a day, I just sat here whilst doing other bits and bobs, just clicking refresh every few minutes. And if you click this probably once a minute, you'll see different different rates come up. Now also, don't forget, it's not just on AVAX, also check the Phantom Network. Because sometimes when they launched, it had some cracking deals, but okay, nothing here at the moment. Let's go back to AVAX. So yeah, and that's all I did. And you can see, I basically, if we look at this, if you look at the history of my wallet, you can see I've done all sorts of different minting, whether it's, you know, wrapped ether to, yeah, there's loads of stuff. That's all I've been doing. I've been redeeming stuff, and yeah, just taking more discounts. In fact, today I got something like a, what did I get today? I literally did it probably a few hours ago. Here we go. Just sold some memo to capitalize on a nice minting offer. Just made an extra 22 time, which is nice. So yeah, it was this thing over here. But yeah, that's about it. Putting my money in my mouth is check. Yeah, Phantom. Yeah, that's it. Oh, 22 minutes. I'm not good with short videos. In my head, I had this down for 10 minutes. but yeah. Anywho. Hope all is well. Chat soon. Bye.